Good morning, and I welcome you to worship as once again we are gathered by God's Holy Spirit in order to be gifted with the wisdom that comes from above. If you're first-time visitors, if you're first-time worshipers with us, we extend warm welcomes. We ask a favor. There is a visitor registration card. Would you please fill that out? And then when the offering plate comes by, you may put it in there. We would appreciate that. This is our 8:30 worship. It's more traditional in its format. So the green bulletin will direct us through it. We'll be in the hymnal. We'll also have it projected for you. The inside, the pink pages, is all the announcements. Our secretary goes to great effort to produce a mini book almost every week for you so that you have all the information you could possibly need. So we hope you read it. So I'm not going to elaborate on that. I will point out property and equipment is meeting. If they might want to meet in the committee room across from the library, so they could grab their goodies and meet during that time. And also we thank the family of Clarence Meadema for the flowers which they have shared with us, as we also remind you to keep them in your prayers. Happy birthday today, John Fisher, Fran Rice, both celebrating birthdays. And as we are in college football season, I'm reminded of a story by Lou Holtz. And I'm missing him. He used to be on some ESPN college game day thing, but he's not on that anymore. But Lou Holtz has the story of when he was the coach at Notre Dame. He said that Notre Dame was having a particularly troubling year that year, and he has gone out to eat with his wife at a restaurant, and he says, sure enough, a waiter comes up to serve him, and the waiter says, do you know the difference between Notre Dame and Cheerios? And Holtz goes, no. He goes, Cheerios belong in a bowl. Now, Lou Holtz is not one to hold his tongue. He replied back, do you know the difference between Lou Holtz and a golf pro? A golf pro gives tips. Please stand, welcome one another in the name of our Lord. You may be seated. Oh yeah, there's one announcement I did miss there. Welcome back, Ryan. Ryan Renz is back from deployment in Korea, so we're happy to have him worshiping with us. We're ready for worship. I invite you to turn to page 21 in the front part of your hymnals for our service. We're gathered in the name of our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sin to God our Father, imploring Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess to you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Therefore, we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Most merciful God, you have given your only Son to die for us. Have mercy on us. And for his sake, grant us remission of all our sins. By your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, so that by your grace we may come to everlasting life. Through through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. Therefore, by the authority of God's word, I declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may stand as we sing our opening hymn. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Glory be to God on high and on earth, peace, goodwill to all. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose strength is made perfect in weakness, grant us humility and childlike faith that we may please you in both will and deed. This we pray through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we hear God's word from Holy Scripture.
Morning. Our first lesson is from Jeremiah 11, 18 through 20, page 640 in the Pew Bible and page 840 in the NIV Children's Bible. The Lord reveals to Jeremiah that his hometown people are plotting to kill him. It is not unexpected that those rebelling against God will seek to silence his spokesperson. Jeremiah knows that this cannot be. Beginning with verse 18. The Lord made it known to me, and I knew. Then you showed me their deeds, but I was like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter. I did not know it was against me. They devised schemes, saying, let us destroy the tree with its fruit. Let us cut him off from the land of the living, that his name be remembered no more. But, O Lord of hosts, who judges righteously, who tests the heart and the mind, let me see your vengeance upon them, for to you I have committed my cause. The word of the Lord. Please turn to page 475 in the Pew Bible to let us read responsively Psalm 54. Page 475. O God, save me by your name.
And vindicate me by your might.
O God, hear my prayer.
Give ear to the words of my mouth.
For strangers have risen against me. Behold, God is my helper.
The Lord is my helper of my life.
He will return the evil to my enemies.
In your faithfulness, lay an end to them.
With a free will offering, I will sacrifice to you.
I will give thanks to your name, O Lord, for it is good.
For he has delivered me from every trouble. The second lesson is from the third and fourth chapters of James, found on page 1012 in your Pew Bible and page 1356 in the NIV Children's Bible. Worldly wisdom will always result in spiritual adultery, seeking something other than God as given in Jesus Christ. Beginning with verse 13. Who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. This is not the wisdom that comes down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder and every vile practice. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. What causes quarrels and what causes fights among you? Is it not this, that your passions are at war within you? You desire and do not have, so you murder. You covet and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly, to spend it on your passions. You adulterous people, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you suppose that it is no purpose that the scripture says, he yearns jealously over the spirit that he has made to dwell in us? But he gives more grace. Therefore it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. the word of the Lord. Please stand for the singing of the Hallelujah verse found on page 25 of the Reclaim Hymnal.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 9th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. I begin at verse 30. Jesus and his disciples went on from there and passed through Galilee, and he did not want anyone to know, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And when he is killed, after 3 days, he will rise." But they did not understand the saying and were afraid to ask him. And they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you discussing on the way?" But they kept silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. And he sat down and called the 12, and he said to them, "If anyone would be first, he must be last of all and servant of all." And he took a child and put him in the midst of them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever receives one such child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. I invite the children to come forward for a children's sermon. Good morning. Today we have another special guest. We have with us today the King of the Jungle. Hey there. Well, hello, Leo. How did you ever get to become king? Well, it's a long story, but I am the greatest in the jungle, and so they call me the King of the Jungle. Wow. You know, I was king once. You were? Don't act so shocked. I was king once. And what were you king of? I was king of the mountain. What? Well, actually, I have a drawing of this. I probably made this, I don't remember when, but it's a drawing of me. I made this of me when I was king of the mountain. It looks like a dirt mound. Well, it was. When we were little kids, we would find a mound of dirt, and then we would all be fighting over who could be at the top. You were fighting? Well, you would, yeah, try to throw somebody else off and be the only one left on the mound of dirt. So you were taking your friends and throwing them down, maybe hurting them. Well, yeah. And why did you do that? It was fun at the time to hurt your friends. Well, but I was king then of the mountain. It's a dirt mound. Well, yeah, but you were trying to be king of the dirt mound. And why? Well, see, then it proved that you were the greatest at throwing people down off dirt. Well, no, I was the greatest because I was left standing on the mountain. It's a dirt mound. Well, yes, but see, I was the greatest at standing on a dirt mound. And what's so great about that? I don't know. It just seemed great at the time until somebody threw you off. Well, yeah, that always happened later because you would claim that you were king in a mountain and then somebody else would come up there and throw you off. And then you got hurt. Well, yeah. But then I'd run home to mommy and cry and she would take care of me. This sounds rather strange. When you keep asking these questions like that, yes, it's strange. But see, I was king. I don't think that's king. I think it's sort of sad. Yeah, maybe sometimes it is. When we try to be king of something, even a dirt mound, maybe it is sort of sad. In fact, Jesus said he's king, which means we're not. And that's the one thing we try to remember in life, is that our greatness does not come from standing on top of a dirt mound. Our greatness comes from him that he gives to us. And so he made the lion to be who he is, which is king of the jungle, and he made us to be who we are, and we shouldn't be, I guess, throwing people off dirt mounds trying to claim that we're king because, well, it just means that everybody gets hurt. Yes, that is how it comes down to in the end. So, well, let's see. What have we got? We have, you know what you're doing today for Sunday school? I hear there's some stuff that's made of apples for you to eat. That sounds pretty good. So you got to wait for Sunday school, but until that time, I've still got some of these fruit things left over. And I think there's one apple one. Oh, nope, there are two apple little notepads. And there's also goofy grape and something pear and bonkers banana and nothing rhymes with orange, and Sally strawberry, and Adam apple, and those. So you each can have one of those, and take them back, and then you can practice drawing on them, okay?
Thank you. mercy and peace be unto you.
From God our Father, from our Lord, from our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Who is wise and understanding among you? Asked James. Good question. But before we answer, we need a few preliminaries out of the way. First of all, this is the world. This will be my representation of God. I don't know, I might have created a monster last week when I'm trying to get illustrations into my adult sermon now too. But here goes again. So notice that the world is not God. And God is not the world. Although God created the world, God is in the world, but God is not the world. They are separate and distinct. There is world, there is God. Okay, this is basic. But the world operates according to its standards. And God will operate apart from worldly standards. The question, who is wise and understanding among you? To answer, we must first ask, are you asking this according to the wisdom of the world, or are you asking this according to the wisdom that comes from God? In the world, wisdom is those who are the most learned. And so formal education, we used to call it book learning. We would say, these are the wise who have gotten many degrees, who have gone through many graduations. There's kindergarten graduation, but that's not the same as when you graduate from post-secondary education. But also there is another wisdom in the world, not the formal wisdom and the book learning. There is that informal, some people call it street wise. Learning the survival skills on the streets of Detroit or Chicago or Worthing, where maybe those who are book wise will not be able to survive. Practical, useful wisdom counts in the world, so that somebody with maybe just a 8th grade education can be a business success and be a millionaire, even with only an 8th grade education. So there's many types of wisdom within the world, and they all vary. But James, when he's asking this question, does not equate worldly, earthly wisdom to the godly wisdom. He says, to live in bitter jealousy and selfish ambition, to boast, this, James says, is not the wisdom that comes from above, but is rather earthly wisdom. So that when Jesus is walking from Capernaum with his disciples and he has to ask them, what were you discussing on the road? They were arguing over who is the greatest according to worldly standards. Who is the greatest? Also, who is wise among us? Which standard are we talking about? Jesus had to answer his disciples when they admitted, yes, we were arguing about greatness. He says, if anyone would be first, he must be last of all and servant of all. Was he speaking in perspective of worldly wisdom? No. He was speaking in perspective of godly wisdom. To be first, you must be last. To gain your life, you must lose your life, does not make sense according to worldly wisdom. I've shared the story before of my philosophy professor at the university who even back then, he was a little weird, but I won't get into that. Almost a requirement for philosophy, I don't know. But he would come and he would have you doing, it was a basic introduction to logic, you know, where you're going, if A is B and B is C, then A is C, type of logical formulas, and then he would give you sentences. He delighted in giving you all the sayings of Jesus, and that you had to show logically that this is illogical. This doesn't make sense. The first or last? No. That can't compute. To gain your life, you have to lose your life. Of course, that doesn't compute. But of course, Jesus knows this, but he is the truth himself. He is the walking personification of what is true. Every word that proceeds from Jesus' mouth declares what is. This is not open to debate, because God says, God does. So that when Jesus says, blessed are the poor, for they shall inherit the earth, he is not lifting up a proposition for us to debate and go, how is it that the poor are going to be blessed? I don't understand. No. He is declaring that those who are poor, those who are weak, those who cannot, will be given and blessed with the kingdom of heaven. He is talking completely different. And of course, when he says it, it is. God says, God does. It is done in the declaration. So that when he gives the kingdom of heaven to all the poor, it is done. All of this, of course, is not logical according to worldly wisdom. This you do not learn in some course at school. This is not even experienced on the street. If you go out in the street, you discover the poor are simply red meat for the predatory lenders of our world. The wisdom of the world cannot accept this as true. Jesus' proposition, the meek will inherit the earth, is never shown or experienced. Yet, it is what is because God has said so. What I'm saying, there are two wisdoms that we live with. There is worldly wisdom. There is the godly wisdom, as James says, that comes from above. And this means you will always be in conflict, because if a person has only worldly wisdom, they are not going to understand a person who lives by both worldly wisdom and the wisdom of God. There is going to be natural conflict there. Greatness according to the world, well, it depends upon what you are able to seize and have and possess. Seize the day, carpe diem, is of course how you go about getting what you need for success according to the world. So if I have lots of money, I have lots of possessions, I have the status system of fancy cars, big houses, a Benelli Super Black Eagle 2 in mossy oak dead grass. Where's my mind? Who is greater? Well, the world says the one with the most toys is the greatest, or the one with the most power is the greatest. Who's sitting at the right hand? Who is sitting at the left hand? Who has the largest war chest for re-election? Who has the poll numbers right now? This wisdom is tangible. I have a championship ring. You don't have a championship ring. That means I'm greater. Yet, even in the world, there's always debate. Is it that the BMW on the driveway is a status symbol, or is it that you have paid off your house loan? I mean, you can debate that. What's the greatest 100 songs ever? That's going to be debated. This is the way it is in the wisdom of the world, and we think everything is open for debate. Then there is God coming into our world with a whole different criteria. And this is interesting. God's greatness has nothing to do with us. When we are great, it's not us. It is God. So that even those who are last will be first. Those who are least will be greatest. God has a whole different criteria of what is greatness. And it is determined by His wisdom, and it has nothing to do with us and worldly wisdom. It has everything to do with Him. Let me repeat that. Greatness has nothing to do with us. It has everything to do with Him. In this debate over greatness, there's a twist in that story that puzzled me for a long time. Jesus discovers his disciples have been arguing over who's greatest. And then it says, and Jesus took a child and put him in the midst of them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, whoever receives one such child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me. Jesus took a child. Now, understanding children back then were sort of insignificant. They hadn't done anything. They haven't accomplished anything. They were not of great worth. You didn't have child stars back then. So Jesus takes a child in his arms. Stop right there. Jesus takes a child in his arms. Image that in your brain. A nameless child out of the rabble of the dusty children running around the town is now in Jesus' arms. That is not cardboard stuff Jesus is using, but that is Jesus' illustration of his sermon. Oh, what's his sermon? He's going to tell them who is the greatest. There's his answer. It's in the illustration. Jesus takes a child, places it in the midst of them, then he takes it in his arms. Do you see it? Are you getting it? Is it revealed to you? Now, don't look at it from the wisdom of the world, because the wisdom of the world is going, what did the kid just do? Nothing. The kid's just gets selected, just gets grasped, and is held in Jesus' arms. The child was a nobody. Even today, it's unnamed. This unnamed child, no name, doesn't have any statues in his honor, no foundations are set up in his name. We don't even know the name. It's just a child. But what is significant is that the child is taken and held in Jesus' arms. That, says Jesus, is greatness. There is greatness according to the wisdom of God. If anyone would be first, he must be last. Servant of all. He doesn't count. What counts is God and what God does for us. Wisdom of the world says everything that counts is what we do. God says what counts is what I have done for you in Jesus Christ, as Jesus takes up an insignificant child, holds him in his arms. Now, this is so strange. Jesus didn't come for winners, therefore. Apologies to the Donald. He didn't come for the last. He didn't come for the lost. He came for sinners. Meaning, greatness, according to God, is not ours to seize and take. It is gifted to us, given to us to be received in faith as Jesus brings us and carries us so that all that is His is now ours. This greatness is given, promised. We receive it in faith. Oh, I can jump, mentioning faith, I can jump to last week's sermon, where I started having to use these illustrations. Last week's sermon, here is God, here is us. Who's greater? Where are we? We're at the bottom. We're last. We're nothing. God is everything. But when God takes us and holds us in his arms, this is our greatness. We are gifted it by what God does. Now, the world and the wisdom of the world doesn't get this. It can't, because it is by its own wisdom. This comes from above, says James. From God, by his will, not our will. Okay, so what am I saying? Don't go and seize the day. Don't be educated because it doesn't matter. You don't need all these degrees. No. Don't. And yes, we can select winners to lead us. That is the wisdom of the world in which we live in the world. We have to operate by the wisdom of the world. We have to be able to say, well, this is logical, this is not. If I spend more money than I'm making, that might not be good. I mean, you live by the wisdom of the world. But we have been gifted with a second wisdom. And we live with both wisdoms in the world, but this makes us not of the world. So that we know, yes, this is the world. This is how the world operates. But we know something else. And this is always going to make us a little bit different than them. This is just going to be natural. We will go forth and we will say things because we have been chosen and held by God to live now differently as new creations who have received the wisdom from above and not as our old creations that had none of this gifted unto us. The world cannot hear this. It will not hear this. It doesn't know of this unless we go and tell. Notice when Jesus said his greatness is to be servant of all. Servants do the master's bidding. And Jesus has told us and has made us wise to his ways within the world. And now we sit here going, all right, now what? We have something to give to the world. It is the wisdom that comes from above. This is why we give of our time, talents, treasures. We are servants because we are seeking to serve our fellow human beings by giving them the wisdom that is not there. And so the church exists to give, to be servants, but to serve by giving what people do not have. So this is our life now, that we have been made great because Jesus has come, he has taken us in his arms, and this makes us great. But now we have this understanding, this gift, this wisdom to go and give to others as we give them Jesus. Amen. You notice the flow of worship here is that from the proclaimed word, then we go to something called the Apostles' Creed. And the Apostles' Creed is a historic confession of faith that we have received from above and not from the world. And therefore, when we declare this, when we speak this, it is a speaking of God's wisdom to a world, to ourselves again, that does not know this unless it is gifted. And so I invite you to turn to page, let's say, 28, and let us stand as we boldly proclaim this wisdom from above. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven. The distinction between a Christian and one who has not been swept up in Christ's arms and held by him is, of course, that we operate from different criteria of what is wisdom. When we have Sunday school for our young people and our old people and our adults, we are seeking to give God's word, which creates faith, which then brings us into that criteria of the wisdom of God. And this is important because you're not going to get it from the world. The world does not know it. The world cannot give what it doesn't have. We have been gifted with the gospel of Jesus Christ, with his word, and this we are commanded to pass on. And so Sunday school is just one of the means, but a very important mean, by which we seek to not just pass on knowledge, but pass on the wisdom that comes from God's actions upon us. And we want to honor the volunteers of our congregation who have answered the call and are committing themselves to passing on this faith to our young people. And so those who are present at this service here today, as I call your name, would you please come forward to the chancel? We would like to install you as our teachers. Kara Eichen, Robin Rao, Sarah Stever, Paula Michelle McVeigh, Diane Abbas, Krista Musser, Bree Van Meteren, Corey and Ashley Muntz, Brian and Lori Spader, Molly Van Meteren, Melinda Steen, Brock Steen, Mike and Julie Bosma, Dan and Jill Severson, Lori Philippi, Elias Youngquist, Leslie Filling, Kim Poppinga-Smith, Amy Juffer, Jen Nessine, Michelle Vieta, Rhonda Youngquist, Byron Youngquist, Lori Philippi, Julie Hinker, and Molly again. From 1 Corinthians 15, Paul writes, "Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the gospel I proclaim to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word that was proclaimed to you." From Romans 10. "How are people to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? And as it is said, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ." The proclaiming and preaching of the saving word of God in Jesus Christ comes in many forms. It might come from one who stands in a pulpit and preaches with some goofy illustrations, or it may come from a parent who is preaching to their children in the everyday incidents of life, or it may come from teachers who have volunteered to be a part of our Sunday school program in order that they might hear of Christ, and in hearing, they might come to believe. So, dear fellow preachers and partners in ministry of First English Lutheran Church, you have volunteered to help proclaim the saving word of God to children who have been called by our Heavenly Father. I ask you, Will you rely upon God's Holy Spirit that has called you and to bless you, to empower you to preach and teach his holy word in all its truth and power? If so, say, we will, and we ask God to help us. I ask all the parents and congregational members here, will you continue to preach and teach in your daily lifestyle and continue in the promises that were made at holy baptism? If so, yes, by the help of God. Will you, as the members of our congregation, remember these educational leaders and preachers in your prayers in the days and weeks and ahead of this year? If so, answer, we will. We ask God. We will, and we ask God to help and guide us. Let us pray. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, keep us steadfast in your word, that we might continue to pass on as first importance that which we have received, your gospel of new life in Jesus Christ. May we never tire of faithfully passing on what has brought us life in our hearing. Amen. Thank you for volunteering and being a part of our program this year. And now we continue in our service, which means that in order for us to be proclaiming this wisdom that the world does not have, we will take up an offering in order to do so. Let us lift up our petitions before God, asking him for that which we need, knowing that he will grant us all that is needful in our daily lives. Lord Jesus, teach your church the way of true humility and gracious service in your name. Give it purity and gentleness, which mark your wisdom. Keep it faithful to you, even in the face of the world's hostility. And use your church to draw many who are far away close to you. Lord, in your mercy, bestow your gracious spirit upon all who suffer because they confess you as Lord and God. Give them that same wisdom, purity, and gentleness that you may soften the hearts of those who hate them and crown their faithfulness with your dearest blessings. Lord, in your mercy. It is easy, Lord, to speak of being your servant, church. But of course, this is hard for us to do and impossible for us to do. We are dependent upon you and your service within us. For this we pray, Lord, in your mercy. Grant to the rulers and nations a measure of heavenly wisdom, or at least just worldly wisdom, to be able to serve humanity in the midst of calamities and natural disasters and in the midst of human sinfulness. Lord, in your mercy. Give a courageous and willing heart to all who serve in our military. We especially remember Ryan. We're thankful that he is back home now. We pray for Adam Cruzy, Sam Winter, as well as others we lift up to you. Bless them that they might be about doing wisdom within this your world. Lord, in your mercy. Bring your mercy and healing to everyone who suffers, whether it be in body, mind, or spirit. We lift up before you today Ethel Thomas, Ellen Van Meteren, Dolores Ganshaw, Jan Newell, Clarice Wells, Carrie Hartman, Dennis Wolman, Gary Poppinga, and the others that we lift up to you. We ask always that they might know that you are present and that you have lifted them up and that they are in your lap. Lord, in your mercy. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for winning forgiveness, salvation, eternal life for all who turn to you in faith. We entrust into your care our departed loved ones, especially Dorothy Youngquist, as well as others that we name to you. Comfort those whose loss is sharp. Bring us into the blessed rest that you have prepared for all your redeemed. This we pray, Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, merciful Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 32.